I was born in Italy and I was an associate professor of pharmacology in the Department of Pharmacology at the University of Cagliari. When I look around and I saw that there was not much opportunity to do real science, was after the Second World War. I applied for a Fulbright Fellowship. I won it and I came to the United States in Chicago. I worked for a period in a Department of Physiology where I was working on the cross-circulation of the dogs and tried to measure, not insulin, but another factor at that time was unknown, causes hyperglycemia. Turned out that it was glucagon. I did that was to find out whether glucagon was acting also on the glycogen, on the muscle, and it's not. And that made a little bit of noise. And while I was presenting this data, a local meeting of a society in Chicago, a gentleman approached me. He worked intensively on the metabolism of glucose in the brain and on the action of insulin on glucose metabolism in the brain. He invited me to go to Gersburg, Illinois, and to work with him for a few months. There was an institute, Psychiatric Institute of Chicago. At that time was stationed in Gersburg, and the institute was directed by Himmich. When I arrived in July, it was very hot. I did not have an air conditioning in the room, and the only place that was cool was the laboratory. So I spent the day and night in the laboratory because it was cool and nice. And at that time came out a paper by Gallon that LSD was inhibiting serotonin response. And I decided to do some work on LSD to find out in different preparations. And I found out that the effect of LSD was different in various preparations. And I published a paper saying that perhaps serotonin has different receptor if LSD is acting only of serotonin. The end of my stay with Himmich, he developed a very good relationship between the two of us, and he asked me whether I was interested that he would ask for from the state of Illinois for me to ask for a visa for permanent immigration in the United States. I accepted. I left the United States in December, and in April I was emigrating with my little son, Max, 2 years old, my wife, and all the belongings, and starting a new life in the United States. And I became interested in the distribution of serotonin in the human brain. And the first distribution of serotonin and the presence of serotonin in humans was shown by this paper. At that time was, an avant-garde paper. Because while the serotonin was present in the brain of many animal species, it was present also in bananas. Therefore, there was some skepticism that something present in bananas could have a very active action in the human brain. And after all, nobody knows whether it's present in human brain. It was present in blood, and that was serotonin came from that work. Actually, serotonin was discovered by another Italian that I admire, Professor Spamel, that called it enteramine. And a page that was studying physiology of the circulatory system and discovered in the blood and call it serotonin for that reason. Then later on it was demonstrated that the two things were the same thing. From the distribution of serotonin in the brain, I went immediately to study a new drug. This new drug was imipramine. I was one of the first one because came to visit Dr. Himmich that was working in psychopharmacology, a group of people from Geigy, imipramine was a Geigy drug, and they were interested that Dr. Himmich would do some EEG studies on imipramine. Was not yet even in clinic. Very preliminary studies were made by a physician in Switzerland. Geigy had synthesized imipramine to be another chlorpromazine. And this guy was very astute, and he saw that was not doing not so much in the schizophrenic, but was active in the depressed patient. So Geigy wanted to know from Himmich what was the effect of the EEG, and brought the drug there. I took the drug, and I wanted to see what was the mechanism of action. And I tested the drug on Reserpine. And I noticed that if you give a high dose of Reserpine, the drug would not do anything. But with small doses of Reserpine, this drug was antagonized the effect of Reserpine, that is ketosis and decrease of motor activity. And I made the hypothesis that perhaps this drug was working on a mechanism that would regulate the action of norepinephrine on the receptor. Later on was discovered by Julie Axelrod that was blocking the reuptake. At that time, reuptake was not even considered. But this was the first time in which was pointed out that imipramine may allow norepinephrine to stay longer on the receptor. By what mechanism, I did not know. This work on imipramine stimulated the interest of another great man, Dr. Brody, that I met my first meeting in Florida, meeting of the Society of Pharmacology. I thought I had a reservation for a room, but there was no sign. And there was another gentleman there that did not have a room. He told me, oh, let's go, we go together, we take a taxi and we go together. We went around looking for a place to sleep, and we went to a motel, and we started to talk about science and start a relationship that lasted until Dr. Brody died. We didn't attend many meetings. We were always talking science, very long nights of discussion, and I became very interested in this man, and I asked around who was, and they said, this is the guy that has discovered the mechanism of action of reserpine, and has discovered that the decrease of serotonin in the brain causes depression. And they asked, what kind of a guy? Because he said, maybe if you are interested, you can come and work with me. And I said, very difficult to work with this man because he works at odd hours and pretends that you stay with him at night and so forth. Very demanding. So he started to call me in Gersburg to join him. And I was hesitant because when you come in a new country, in a new environment, it's very difficult to make up your mind to change something good for something that you don't know, and people say that is difficult. But he invited me to give lectures on my work together with my wife. And my wife came to me with me to Washington. And immediately understood that my wife was not happy in Gettysburg because it was a small town, and impressed her that how beautiful was Washington. And actually we went even to dance with him to show her how big and lively was. I had on one side Dr. Brody calling, on the other side my wife pressuring me, and I decided to go to Washington. It was the best decision in my life. Brody was an extraordinary person. My relationship with him was really, I was learning from him how to think, and he was learning from me a little bit biology. It lasted for a period of 5 years, and I was his deputy chief of this laboratory. And at that point, I realized that it was time for me to move, because I needed to find my way, if I had to find my way in the United States.